It's my deep privilege to welcome you to this celebration of the life of Frances Leona Whittaker Ginn. She may not have been perfect, but she was surely a saint among us. The legacy of her life lived here is reflected in her children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and others who will come, I am sure. In fact, for generations to come, Frances' legacy will live on, well past all of us in this room. Frances believed that stories connect generations. So today, we're going to remember her in many stories. We'll sing some of them, and we will hear some of them. Frances believed that the themes of her life focused around music, mentors, and missions. And I think you'll hear that in the stories about her. She lived in an age when she knew some of the golden era missionaries, knew them personally, had met them, had shaken their hands, probably had them in their home. They were heroes and heroines to all of us in the churches during that time. She was mentored by many people, both in the community and through their writings, many authors that she read. She was not afraid to be taught something by someone else. What an admirable quality. Not afraid to learn from someone else. Frances knew she left a mark in this world. She knew she did. She did it very intentionally. She did it on purpose. She intended to leave a mark, not because she was proud, but because early in her life, she learned the 4-H pledge. Do you even know what I'm talking about, 4-H? I grew up in a rural area, so I know about 4-H. Well, she learned the 4-H pledge, and I think she actually lived by it the rest of her life when you look at the pledge. Making the best better. That's how it begins. Making the best better. My head to clearer thinking. My heart to greater loyalty. My hands to larger service. My health to better living. Wasn't that Frances? She lived that pledge all her life. She lived the kind of life among us that we will miss. We will notice her absence. The strong relationships that family and friends had with her will cause us to alter our habits and our practices. So even while we celebrate her life, we grieve and we mourn that life is no longer lived among us. I have no doubt that she would want us to go on living, not be afraid to shed a tear, enjoy good laughter, and for heaven's sakes, continue to love. That's how we honor her. She always did, in spite of great loss and heartache. In fact, can't you hear her saying, remember, kiss the joy, right? Now, we will do our best to celebrate this life so well lived. Let's pray together. O God, who heard Frances' prayers for so many of us all through the years, would you hear our prayers now as we celebrate the abundant life she lived in you? Our hearts are sad, and we grieve for the loss of her presence with us, but we rejoice for the faith she modeled for us, and that same faith in which she crossed over through the thin place from this existence we know to our lives in you, which we have yet to experience. We can celebrate her life so richly lived because she lived in you and you so obviously lived in her. May our words and thoughts celebrate her and honor you, our loving God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
His hand. Hello, I'm Liz. I'm the oldest, and I own it. I like that title. This is my soon-to-be 12-year-old granddaughter, Faith, and my bestie. And she's going to take over and help me out if I can't get through this. But I'm going to. Maybe. Mom was truly an amazing woman. In addition to being a wonderful wife, mother, grandmother, and great-grandmother, she was a musician, teacher, mentor, artist, writer, seamstress, and more. She was a really good sport. When I was in sixth grade in Camdenton, I got to play the clarinet in the high school marching band, sixth grade, and Bo Houston confirmed that for me a while ago, that was true. I'm not making that up. So I had to wear a black skirt and a white shirt. Well, while she was making my skirt, I could say, make it tighter, make it tighter. And by the time she said when that skirt was finished, it was about the size of a stovepipe. But she was a good sport about it. Then there was a time in fourth grade when my friend Ann Blair and I planned a surprise birthday party for our teacher, except forgot one important little detail. I had to go to the office and call Mom and say, we need cupcakes for the whole class today. She made them from scratch. That's what she did. Whatever she put her mind to, she made it happen. In 2018, Mom suffered a major stroke. Because of her strong will to live and incredible hard work in physical therapy and occupational therapy, she was able to move to an independent living apartment at Our Lady of Mercy. In 2019, the facility decided to hold a prom for the residents. Well, Mom was excited to pick the perfect outfit and jewelry. We did her hair, her makeup. She said her only regret was that she wouldn't be able to dance, and that got my wheels spinning. Mom liked to dance. Dad, not so much, because he said she always tried to lead. Go, Mom. I called the administrator and asked if the exercise instructor Bourne planned to attend the dance. Mom had to use a walker because of her neuropathy in her legs. She went to Bourne's classes regularly, and I knew she would trust him. I asked if Bourne could surprise Mom and ask her to dance. Bourne walked up to her that night, asked her to join him on the dance floor. Mom said she thought she could try it without her walker if he would hold her steady. So Bourne held her, and they swayed to the music. When I was going through cancer treatment, Becky gave me a little plaque that said, "Sometimes the dance is in our heads, sometimes in our hands, sometimes in our feet, but dance we must." I believe Mom's dance card was filled with life experiences. One of her favorite mottos was kiss the joy, and she did every hour of every day of her 95 years. No, go ahead.
In one of Dad's journals, he wrote, "The person I love and respect most highly is my wife. She has blessed the lives of many people in my pastorates. She has been a partner with me in ministry and has blessed and encouraged our four children and their lives and careers." Well said, Dad. Thanks to all of you for our prayers, visits, and hundreds of cards. Every single card was read and cherished. You have had a special place in her rich and blessed life story.
I'm Becky, the second in line. And I'm glad she was first, because she's always been there for me and been by my side, and she mentors me, too, so I'm glad she was first. Moms and my visits often either involved watching her beloved Second Baptist Church worship services online, or talking about our Christian faith, or both. It was very important to Mom to express her faith by living the words of the prayer of St. Francis of Assisi. The words of the prayer are right there in Mom's beautiful calligraphy, and David will be singing them beautifully shortly. But it says,
"Saint Francis of Liberty."
Of Liberty. Oh, okay. Prayer of St. Francis with an E of Liberty. Okay. I like that, David. But it says in part, if you don't know the words, I think most of you do, but, "Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there's hatred, let me sow love. And then toward the end, O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be loved as to love. In recent years, Mom grieved the fact that she couldn't minister to others in the way she once had. Her mobility issues pretty much confined her to the wonderful Preston floor of the Laurel Building at Norterre. Liz and I reassured her often that she was doing a lot to make a difference in her little corner of the world. Here are just a few examples. Mom gave her trademark wave to any residents whose doors were open as she walked to the dining room. She gave her beautiful smile to the other people at the dining table on the Preston floor. She would tell me later, I can't hear them or see them very well, but I can still smile. And people loved her smile. She dictated numerous sympathy and get well cards to me. Some of you received them as little as 3 weeks ago from her. She would dictate these cards to me to send to friends and family and had me read them back to her to make sure I had not changed any of her wording.
So true. So true.
She wanted our visits to be more than just doing chores for her. She also wanted us to have fun. So we played double shutter at every single visit. She could have made it a little more fun by letting us win once in a while, though, right, Liz?
It wouldn't happen.
During her recent hospitalization, she sweetly and graciously continued to thank the doctors and the fabulous staff on 7 South at Liberty Hospital, even when they didn't have any good news to share. And finally, she loved her kids, grandkids, and great-grandkids completely and most certainly unconditionally. So in her own quiet way, she did continue to minister to others. My childhood friend, Kim Dolan Martin, who was a member at Wynwood Baptist Church when Dad was pastor there, said this about Mom. I always remember your mom as a quiet, gentle soul serving God wherever she saw need and as she just passed by. I was fortunate and blessed to have been where she passed by. In my opinion, we all were.
I'm James Whitaker Ginn. Thank you all for being here today. As you know, my mother was a beautiful, intelligent, talented, devout, and kind lady. In this chaotic and increasingly angry world, Mom was a source of comfort to the many who knew and loved her. She was an encourager. Her gentle smile and her empathetic spirit somehow made life's struggles a little less overwhelming. Mom gave me the precious gift of my life, and she was always my strongest advocate. Every moment hence, her presence in my heart will strengthen me. I will remember her profound wisdom that never ceased to inspire me, her brilliant musicianship that seemed to spring effortlessly from her very essence, her deep and continuously evolving faith that served as a model for my own spiritual journey, her exquisite handiwork that provides an enduring reflection of her beauty, her unfailing and unconditional love for her only son, just as I am, a love that shone in clear blue eyes growing grayer over the decades, but never less full of life and integrity. These memories will sustain me, and I am confident that one day, not so long from now in the greater scheme of things, I will see Mom again, pure love, radiant light, as she joyfully welcomes me home.
Okay, now being the baby of the family, do you see the hard act I had to follow? know if it's good being last. You're a hard act to follow, you guys. I stand before you this morning, along with my siblings, humbled and honored to call this amazing woman mom. Nothing I say could ever be enough to express my love and gratitude. While gathering and choosing pictures for Mom's monumental birthday celebration in June, it occurred to me how much life she had lived. 95 years and 60 days of living, to be exact, with a whole lot of living packed into every moment. She lived them so beautifully and blessed all of us along the way. After settling on the 10 pictures for her birthday banner, I found myself thinking of all the pictures that could have been squeezed in between each of those pictures. And then I thought of pictures that only exist in the album of my heart, but are as real to me as if I could hold them in my hand. Here are just a few. Calling Mom in the middle of the night to come scratch my back. Always reading just one more book before bedtime. Baking orange rolls on Sunday morning before church, a pack of eight, Dad two, the kids one and a fourth, and one for Mom. Cooking all those wonderful meals that always included a yummy dessert. Camping with four young children, making it look so easy. How did she do that? Singing to me, if God so loved the little birds, I know he loves me too. Sitting on the back steps of the parsonage, watching me do cartwheel after cartwheel and clapping every time, my best cheerleader. Letting me stay home from kindergarten the afternoon Dad set up the brand new ping pong table. Placing my head in her lap on the heating pad when I had an earache. Staying up late sewing all my prom dresses, pom-pom outfits, skating dresses, costumes, swimsuits, and even matching dresses for me, Abby, and her doll. Getting up early in the morning and listening to the radio to see if we were going to have any snow days, always crossing our fingers, letting me put the push pins on the map of places we've been that hung above the organ in the parsonage, meeting Craig and welcoming him into our family, picking out my wedding dress at Metro North and finding the perfect one. All the trips she made to Colorado, especially when Aaron and Abby were born, and getting up in the middle of the night with me, not because she had to, but because she wanted to. Making the trip up to Sioux Falls with Liz and Faith for Aaron and Hillary's wedding reception and holding Hillary's hand in the pictures. Traveling all the way to Hayes, Kansas with Becky and Gary to meet her great-granddaughter, Onyx. Kissing Mom and Dad goodbye after my trips to Kansas City, always knowing I was leaving a better person than when I came. Living life to the fullest, serving and blessing others right up to the end. She gave love and received love so very well. Thanks, Mom, for filling my album with precious memories. Your love will always be with me.
Instrument of thy peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is in dying that we are born to eternal. The
scripture reading is the Gospel of John, chapter 10, and I'm adding verse 27 to 28, and then 14, 1 and 2. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. May of last year, I began weekly visits with Frances when she went to the Laurel at Norterre for what she hoped would be a month of rehab. This became a permanent move. These visits were a time we both looked forward to. In an interview, Billy Graham was once asked when he thought he might retire. His response was, "In my reading of the New Testament, I never saw any place where Jesus talked about retirement." This was Francis. Every 3 months, I would bring her a Sunday school quarterly and the teacher's commentary. She would faithfully study these, and then she would walk down the hall to the apartment of Vonda Johnson, and they would have Sunday school. She also read Nurturing Faith Journal, and we would discuss articles. Regularly, she asked for updates on other church members. During one of our visits, we were talking about Dolores Foreman, who for years was the wedding coordinator here at Second. She said during hers and Harlan's ministry, she had coordinated 850 weddings and 850 funerals. She was concerned about the future of the church. remembering there was a time when she and Harlan were at Wynwood Baptist Church that Sunday school attendance was 600. Now, unable to attend services in person, she looked forward to worshiping with Becky as they watched 2BC on Facebook. Frances and I would then discuss the sermon on Tuesday. I mentioned the book once, Tuesdays with Maury. She had never read that book. I checked it out at the Mid-Continent Library for her. The next week, Frances said she had read the book and had written 6 quotes in her journal, which then she read to me. From that time on, my visits were Tuesday with Charlie. Last July, when a forest fire in Washington State threatened Jim's home, we prayed for a miracle. When I came the next Tuesday, we celebrated that the prayer had been answered and the home spared. To the end, Frances was a dedicated, active, and faithful believer. I was blessed to have these times with her.
Soon after Jason and Christy Edwards came to second, Jason led our congregation in understanding the concept of community groups. He encouraged us to join a small group of people who had a common theme. Ours was missions, and 9 of us committed to a year of regular attendance on Tuesday evenings. Our group consisted of Jason and Christy, Jen and Jason Diltz, Karen Rogers, my husband Harold and me, and Frances and Harlan. It was a wonderful mix of generations. We took this time very seriously. We met every Tuesday night at the Edwards home because they had small children and they were able to go upstairs and go to bed while we met. But often you would see Frances over holding baby Luke in her arms when he was trying to go to sleep. We ate tacos every week. Every week. The only thing that changed was who was going to bring what ingredients. And if Jason Diltz was in charge of meat for that week, we were in for a big treat because he always concocted something special. And it wasn't just for that year. We had such a bond together that we decided we would meet 3 years. And so we had tacos for 3 years. One of our assignments was writing our own spiritual autobiography, and then we met together on those Tuesday evenings and shared our autobiographies with each other. And I remember feeling a bit intimidated because I felt like my story was a bit piddly compared to the saints, Frances and Harlan. Our stories were so intriguing to hear, and it really helped us to connect our generations. Years later, Frances, by the way, put her life story down on paper, and it's wonderful to see the events of her life and what brought all of that together. My fondest memory of our group was being able to do missions together on a trip to Hell's Kitchen in New York City. We learned together, we worked and served side by side, we ate together, we prayed, we walked up 10 flights of steps to sleep every night, and then we enjoyed the city nightlife together. Frances had told us that one of Harlan's lifelong dreams was to be able to see a Broadway show, and we got to do that together. We saw Phantom of the Opera and Mary Poppins. It was so fun to see Mary leaping out across all of us, and we just enjoyed that so much. You know, I truly believe that it was a God thing that allowed the 9 of us to have these 3 years together, and I'll never forget it. taken from Philippians 1. I thank my God every time I remember you, these nine. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy.
There is an absurdly funny British movie that's entitled Death at a Funeral. I knew you would have seen this movie. I knew this was your cup of tea. In it is a rather overly conscientious man who keeps trying to give his father's eulogy at the funeral. And because it's a British comedy, nothing goes as planned, right? And he keeps getting interrupted. So 100 times you hear this line, my father was a remarkable man. That's how he hopes to begin the eulogy. I just can't shake thinking these words about Frances, not about my father, but our Frances was a truly remarkable woman. A truly remarkable woman. And having spent 95 years on this earth and rather successfully navigating these years, one would say, well, frankly, that was a remarkable feat. As Jim said, her faith was always evolving. It was front and center, but it was never static. That's remarkable. She listened for God's messages all of her life, and she was willing to adopt, adapt, and change. And that's hard for every one of us, but boy, she did it. No wonder John 14 was a favorite passage for her as a sort of centering and source of comfort for all the years of her life. The first passages she studied in her personal Bible study as she was growing in the faith were the Gospels, and she became, in her own words, rather familiar with them, and I suspect she was. It's little wonder to me, though, that the Gospel of John, this theological book, this kind of heavy lifting book in the New Testament among the Gospels, was her favorite. And this chapter 14, that was favorite, maybe of all favorite passages for her. This chapter is Jesus comforting his disciples for the ages, for all of us. I think how often we saw your mother, your grandmother's beautiful smile and the joy that it reflected because of her faith in Christ. That's where she lived. Her faith in Jesus' words in this passage. Here are these verses, now 5 through 7, I read from this chapter 14. Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." And I kind of think that when Jesus said that to the disciples, he looked at three different disciples, maybe, with whom he'd had these conversations. Well, what about the way? Well, what is truth? Well, how do we have life? Jesus says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." I loved Frances' honesty when we visited recently, just a couple of weeks ago. She and I talked about doubts and questions about eternal life and what happens after here. Not so much does something happen. She really had no doubt about that. But she was really wondering and asking all of the hows, not what it would be, but what it would be like. And unlike Thomas, she knew where she was going, but as with any of us, it was still a great grand mystery for her. I think it was a mystery to her that in Frances' life, I think God used dreams often to speak to your mother. I don't know if she believed that or not, but she sure shared a lot with us about dreams. Then she felt some kind of message from God. I think God used dreams in your mother's life. Biblical people, ancient Christians, they always put great stock in dreams. And, well, so today, think about it. None of that is a mystery to her anymore. Now she knows the hows and whys. That's good news. When I met with the Ginn siblings, we enjoyed so many memories together. I did. Hope you all did. Toward the end of our time together, Liz just sort of casually mentioned, "You know, well, Mom wrote a book about her life." Now, I didn't know this, and I'm officiating today. Well, how helpful this can be. I grabbed it from her hands and ran out the door. And I said, "I'll give it back one of these days soon." So I have read it and reread parts of these last few days. And I mean that. I'm being very serious with you all. Because it captures an era that generations after her have never experienced. And I believe, my own personal opinion, Frances didn't say this, she's much kinder than I, but I believe that that's why that generation developed a resilience to life that following generations do not seem to have. Grandchildren, especially to you, but to all of the family or any friends who has possession of this book, or if you want to run Liz down and get it from her, you should read this. You should read this book because it is full of wisdom. And you would be the better for knowing what put Frances together in the early part of her life. Not just her faith, but her living. And the things that she really endured. She never saw it that way. Often at the end of the paragraph, after a really hard subject, she would say, and we really had a lot of fun. So she didn't see it as endurance, but what a remarkable life. She grew up on a farm in rural Missouri in a time when Crayolas were magical. They were new, and they were magical. Can you imagine what a simple time this was for her as a child? Mashed potatoes and gravy were a staple food, right? They were on a farm. And I think her attention to detail and tendency to perfectionism were refined in that farm living. You had to pay attention to your crops and your animals and everything that was going on. And she did. And as with any family who grew up on a farm, everyone works and learns every job to be done. It's not boys' jobs and girls' jobs. It's just jobs to be done, and you do it all. I love the story about she and her sister cousin, Lita, hitching each other up, taking turns being the plow horse, while the other one drove the plow. This is our Frances, who was a plow horse when needed to be. That's remarkable. And as she was growing up, they always had food, they always had clothes, because all of those clothes were made there at home. And they harvested and cooked and grew all of the food they had. You never go hungry on a farm.
No electricity. All this was hand done.
You don't have any money, but you don't have any hunger on a farm.
The story of the relationship with her
sister home, think about it. Her home was warmed by wood heat.
She weaves it all throughout her book.
Not a fancy wood furnace.
It's clear that this was a most significant relationship.
You warm the house.
They must
cut
have
wood.
Been inseparable.
And it smelled of freshly baked bread because her mama made it.
Mm-hmm.
Your grandmother
first paid attention
made that
to
bread
Lita.
Every week for the family. And no electricity.
Right? Your mom tells it. She tells it like it is.
Until
right
Frances graduated from high school after high
of
school
course,
in 1945.
Once his head swung to
no
Frances,
electricity. All this was hand done on this little Missouri
Frances
farm.
Had
the story of the relationship with her sister cousin Lita is a beautiful story, and she weaves
and
it all throughout her book. So it's clear
faith,
that this was a most significant relationship to her. They must have been inseparable, even though Harlan
maybe that was part of God's design for life.
Mm-hmm,
she made
first paid attention to Lita.
To live, she understood.
Right? Your mom tells it. She tells it like it is, right here in this book. Of course, once his head swung to Frances, there was no swinging back. Frances had, from early childhood, had wanted to be a wife and a mother. And sometime later in her, as a person of faith, she actually felt that maybe she was called to be a pastor's wife.
That's the hard way
she was
to get a college.
Maybe that was part of God's design for life. She made a commitment to Christ to live as she understood him to lead when she was 11. And in her words, she fell in love with the stories of Jesus.
Jim graduated
a lifelong
that same year,
love.
Her mom tells in her story. And she writes
it's admirable when people who have been out of high school for decades and who are married and who are parents and who are working but realize
really
that they have an opportunity to go to college and they
and
do
not
it.
Boasting about her own,
that's admirable. Her own that's hard. That's the hard way to get a college
really
education. But that's what Frances did.
And I think kind of tickled.
She had an opportunity to go to William Jewell College. And in 1980, she graduated summa cum laude.
Was born the following year.
Jim graduated that same year from Jewell, your mom tells in her story. And she writes in her book that she had a 3.8.
That they probably.
But Jim had a 4.0.
Probably.
And really, she said it with no resentment and not boasting about her own
concerning when they
great achievement, but really proud of Jim and his achievement.
But your mother,
and I think kind of tickled that he beat her.
To lead her through this. She was scared. She tells that.
She and Harlan married in 1951, and their first child was born the following year. Mary Ruth was stillborn.
Faith, the word faith.
And at that time, they received a doctor's warning that they probably, if they had other children, probably those babies also would not live.
Said, Lord,
so this was heartbreaking to them. And it was very concerning when they became pregnant again.
Felt a peace. Then, healthy,
but your mother allowed the mystery of her faith to lead her through this. She was scared. She tells
in her
that
book,
in her story.
Your mom says,
and finally, one day, she prayed.
Was the most beautiful sound.
She kept getting messages. Kept appearing.
Becky,
and she kept hearing people talk about faith. And she noticed in songs that they were about faith. And finally, one day, Frances said, Lord, I just need you to give me faith that this is going
to
be okay.
And she needed to, she would not leave.
She finally felt a peace.
And so she slept.
And then healthy, screaming Liz was born.
Now, she didn't do this
when
she was 35.
In her book, your mom says that your cry was the most beautiful sound she would ever hear. How many ways can a mother tell a child that she loves them?
That what she saw in
Becky, who was by Gary's side at KU Med Center, Gary had had a nearly fatal heart attack.
Pastors
and Frances had gone to KU to be there in support of Becky. And she needed to, she would not leave.
They do their
and
best
so she slept on the floor
will,
of the waiting room
lives in a
as close to
they
Becky as she could. Now, she didn't do this when she was 35.
Only to find themselves being called
she was 78
else.
Years old.
So this means now
when she
a new
did
house,
this, a mother's
a
love.
New school or schools, new friendships, new confidence.
Martha dittoed
pastors,
that what she saw in her siblings' experience was what she experienced in her own relationship
people.
With her mother.
Pastors
and their spouses and their children
a delicate balance
do not have
the importance
an easy life.
Of the church and the
That's the truth of
there,
it. They do their best to discern God's will. They plant their lives in a community. They fall in love with people there, only to find themselves being called somewhere else.
Children,
and so this means now a new house, a new school, or schools, new friendships, new confidants. Pastors, at least the kind of pastors I'm thinking about, are not wealthy people. Pastors and spouses have to find and strike a delicate balance between the importance of the church and the ministries there and the importance of their families and their personal lives.
The dirty linen.
It is a delicate balance.
Probably not perfectly, but
because spouses, and especially children, can grow up resenting the church
and, so they struck the
and all that it represents, even
all of
God,
this,
Christ himself.
In addition to literally
but it appears to me that Harlan and Frances found
and loved
that delicate balance in their authentic faith.
I mentioned
as they raised you all and as they served
many
churches and communities.
And one she mentioned,
probably not perfectly,
met,
if we're going to be honest and tell,
now,
you know, the dirty linen story, probably not perfectly, but
Frederick
they Beagle. Always led with love.
And she included this quote
both
from
directions.
His book, Now and Then, in her
And so they struck the balance.
I quote Frederick Beagle.
All of this in addition to literally a thousand stories about how Frances ministered and loved on people in all the churches they served. I mentioned that Frances was mentored by many notable authors, and one she mentioned, whom she'd not met, except now that I think about it, by now she may have, because he died just a few days ago.
To the holy and hidden heart
Frederick Buechner.
Because in the last analogy,
and she included this quote from his book, Now and Then, in her story.
And life itself.
I quote Frederick Buechner.
Is grace.
Via Frances.
More and more, I draw.
Listen to your life.
Not
see it
as a source of
for the fathomless mystery that it is. In the boredom and the pain of it, no less than the excitement and gladness,
who choose to live it with our friend Jesus.
Touch, taste, smell your way to the holy and hidden heart of it. Because in the last analogies, all moments are key moments, and life itself is grace. More and more, I draw on my own experience, not just as a source of plot, but as a source of truth.
A celebration.
What a remarkable gift abundant life is for those who choose to live it with our friend Jesus. What a remarkable God.
To join together,
Frances,
as we sing a hymn that was sung at Harlan.
And what a remarkable woman.
It's hymn number 409.
And what a remarkable pair, the two of them.
I'm going to ask us all to sing, and we'll sing the first two stanzas.
So, Frances,
if you have
harmony, you would say to us,
sing it.
We will see you.
If you're not a good singer, as Don Brown says, have courage. Let's stand and sing. A celebration of Frances's life and the life she shared with Harland and this family really wouldn't be complete without all of us singing together. And so we're going to ask you all to join together as we sing a hymn that was sung at Harland service as well. It's hymn number 409, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. We're going to ask us all to sing, and we'll sing the first two stanzas. If you have harmony, sing it. If you're not a good singer, as Don Brown says, have courage. Let's stand and sing.
Sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry
trials and tempt
everything to God in prayer.
Is there trouble anymore?
Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. And temptations. Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful, who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Will you be seated, please?
Say hello to them if you've not had a chance to greet them. You see the information about the graveside service that's held in Maysville at 2 o'clock this afternoon, and it is public. All are welcome.
After I pronounce a benediction, if you will just remain seated.
So here's this.
I'm going to stay in the room with you. Hank and
as
his team will take the casket and lead
the
family
the
out.
The
family will stay in that narthex area or maybe just slightly outside if you would like to say hello then, if you've not had a chance to greet them.
That overflows beyond understanding.
You see the information about the graveside service that's held in Maysville at 2 o'clock this afternoon, and it is public. All are welcome to join them in that.
And may the name of Jesus be the one.
So hear this benediction.
You always rely.
As you may go,
the Spirit be known to you.
May the love of God be the passion of your heart. May the joy of God be your strength when times are hard. May the presence of God be a peace that overflows beyond understanding. May the work of God be the seed that you might sow. May the embrace of God be the comfort you desire. And may the name of Jesus be the one on whom you always rely. And may the presence of the Spirit be known to you this and every hour in the days ahead. Amen. Amen.